Okay. Ready? Okay. Chapter 10, King Fred's Quest. King Fred strode from the throne room, feeling quite delighted with himself. Nobody would ever again say that he was selfish, vain, and cruel. For the sake of the smelly, simple old shepherd and his worthless old mongrel, he, King Fred, the fearless, was going to hunt the Ickabog. True, there was no such thing, but it was still dashed fine and noble of him to ride to the other end of the country in person to prove it. Quite forgetting lunch, the king rushed upstairs to his bedroom, shouting for his valet to come and help him out of the dreary black suit and into his battle dress, which he'd never had the chance to wear before. The tunic was scarlet with buttons of gold and a purple sash and lots of medals. Fred was allowed to wear because he was a king. And when Fred looked in the mirror, he saw how well battle dress became him. He wondered why he didn't wear it all the time, as his valet lowered the king's plump helmet onto his golden curls. Fred imagined himself painted wearing it, seated on his favorite milk-white charger and spearing a serpent-like monster with his lance. King Fred, the fearless indeed. Why, he half hoped there was really an Ickabog now. Meanwhile, the chief advisor was sending word throughout the city within the city that the king was setting off on a tour of the country, and that everyone should be ready to cheer him as he left. Herringbone made no mention of the Ickabog because he wanted to prevent the king from looking foolish if he could. Unfortunately, the footman called Gankerby had overheard two advisors muttering together about the king's strange scheme. Gankerby immediately told the between maid, who spread the word all over the kitchen, where a sausage seller from Baronstown was gossiping with the cook. In short, by the time the king's party was ready to leave, word had spread all throughout the king within the city. That the king was riding north to hunt the Ickabog, and news was also beginning to leak out into wider Chosville. Is it a joke? The capital inhabitants asked one another as they thronged out onto the pavements, ready to cheer the king. What does it mean? Some shrugged and laughed and said that the king was merely having fun. Others shook their heads and muttered that there must be more to it than that. No king would ride out armed to the north of the country without good news. What, the worry folk asked one another, does the king know that we do not? Lady Islanda joined the other ladies of the court on the balcony to watch the soldiers assembling. I shall now tell you a secret which nobody else knew. Lady Islanda would never have married the king, even if he'd asked her. You see, she was secretly in love with a man called Captain Goodfellow, who was now chatting and laughing with his good friend Major Beamish in the courtyard below. Lady Islanda, who was very shy, had never been able to bring herself to talk to the Captain Goodfellow, who had no idea the most beautiful woman at the court was in love with him. Both Goodfellow's parents, who were dead, had been cheesemakers from Kurtzburg. Though Goodfellow was both clever and brave, these were the days when the cheesemaker's son would expect to marry a high-born lady. Meanwhile, all the servants' children were being led out of school early to watch the battle party set off. Miss Beamish, the pastry chef, naturally rushed to collect Bert so that he'd have a good spot to watch his father passing by. palace gates open at last, and the cavalcade rode out. Bert and Miss Beamish cheered at the top of their lungs. Nobody had seen battle dress for a very long time. How exciting it was, and how fine. The sunlight played upon the golden buttons, the silver swords, and the gleaming trumpets of the bucklers. And up the palace balcony, the handkerchief of the ladies out of the court fluttered in farewell like doves. At the front of the procession rode King Fred on his milk-white charger, holding scarlet reins and waving at the crowds. Right behind him, riding in the thin yellow horse and wearing bored expression, was Spittleworth. And next came Flapoon, furiously lunchless and sitting on his elephantine chestnut. Behind the king and the two lords strutted the royal guard, all of them on a dapple gray horses, except for Major Beamish, who rode his steel gray stallion. In vain, Miss Beamish heart fluttered to see her husband looking so handsome. "Good luck, Daddy," shouted Bert, and Major Beamish, though he really shouldn't have done, waved at his son. The procession trotted down the hill, smiling and cheering crowds in the city within the city, until it reached the gates in the wall under wider Chosville. There, hidden by the crowds, was the Dovedales' cottage. Mr. Dovedale and Daisy had come out into the gardens, and they were just able to see the plumes in the helmets of the royal guard riding past. Daisy didn't feel much interest in the soldiers. She and Bert still weren't talking to each other. In fact, he spent morning break with Roderick Roach, who often jeered at Daisy for wearing coveralls instead of a dress. So the cheering and the sound of the horses didn't raise her spirits at all. "There isn't really an Ickabog, Daddy, is there?" she asked. "No, Daisy," sighed Mr. Dovedale, turning back to his workshop. "There's no Ickabog. If the king wants to believe in it, let him. He can't do much harm up in the marshlands, which just goes to show that even sensible men may fail to see a terrible looming danger." Chapter 11, The Journey North. King Fred's spirits rose higher and higher as he rode out of Chosville and into the countryside. Word of the king's sudden expedition to find the Ickabog and now spread to the farmers who worked the rolling green fields, and they ran with their families to cheer the king, the two lords, and the royal guard as they passed. Not having had any lunch, the king decided to stop Kurtzberg to eat a late dinner. Well, rough it here. "Chaps like the soldiers we are," he cried to his party as they entered the city famed for its cheese, "and we'll set out again at first light." But of course, there was no question of the king's roughing it. Visitors at Kurtzberg's finest inn were thrown onto the street to make way for him. So Fred slept that night in a brass bed with duck down mattresses. After a hearty meal, a meal of toasted cheese and chocolate fondue, the Lord Spittleworth and Flapoon, on the other hand, were forced to spend the night in a little room over the stables. Both were rather sore after a long day of horseback. You may wonder why that was if they went hunting 5 times a week, but the truth was that they generally sneaked off to sit behind a tree after half an hour's hunting, where they ate sandwiches and drank wine until it was time to go back to the palace. Neither was used to spending hours in the saddle, and Spittleworth's pony bottom was already starting to blister. Early following morning, the king was was brought word by the Major Beamish that the citizens of Barrenstown were very upset. The king had chosen to sleep in Kurtzburg rather than their splendid city. Eager not to dent his popularity, King Fred instructed his party to ride in an enormous circle throughout the surrounding fields, being cheered by the farmers all of the way, so that they ended up in Barrenstown by nightfall. The delicious smell of sizzling sausage greeted the royal party, and the delighted crowd carrying torches escorted Fred to the best room in the city. There was served roasted ox and honey ham, and slept in a carved oak bed with a goose down mattress, while Spittleworth and Flapoon had to share a tiny attic room usually occupied by two maids. By now, Spittleworth's bottom was extremely painful, and he was furious that he'd been forced to ride 40 miles in a circle purely to keep the sausage makers happy. Flapoon, who'd eaten far too much cheese in Kurtzburg and had consumed 3 beefsteaks in Barrenstown, was awake all night groaning with indigestion. Next day, the king and his men set off again, and this time they headed north, soon passing through vineyards from which eager grape pickers emerged to wave cornucopian flags and receive waves from the jubilant king. Spittleworth was almost crying from pain in spite of the cushion he just strapped to his bottom, and Flapoon's belches and moans could be heard even over the clatter of hooves and jingle of bridles. Upon arrival at Jeroboam that evening, they were greeted by trumpets and the entire city singing the national anthem. Fred feasted on sparkling wine and truffles that night before retiring to a silken four-poster bed with a swan-down mattress. But Spittleworth and Flapoon were forced to share a room over the inn's kitchen with a pair of soldiers. Drunken Jeroboam dwellers were reeling about in the street, celebrating the presence of the king in their city. Spittleworth spent much of the night sitting in a bucket of ice, and Flapoon, who drank far too much red wine, spent the same period being sick in a second bucket in the corner. At dawn next morning, the king and his party set out for the marshlands after a famous farewell from the citizens of Jeroboam, who saw him on his way with a thunderous popping of corks and made Spittleworth's horse rear and ditch him on the road. Once they dusted Spittleworth off and put the cushion back on his bottom, and Fred had stopped laughing, the party proceeded. Soon they left Jeroboam behind and could hear only bird song for the first time in their entire journey. The sides of the road were empty. Gradually, the lush green land gave away to thin, dry grass, crooked trees, and boulders. Extraordinary place, isn't it? The cheerful king shouted back to Spittleworth and Flapoon. I'm jolly glad to see the marshlands at last, aren't you? The two lords agreed, but once Fred had turned to face the front again, they made rude gestures and mouthed even ruder names at the back of his head. At last, the royal party came across a few people, and how the marshlanders stared. They fell to their knees like the shepherd in the throne room, and quite forgot to cheer and clap, but gaped as though they'd never seen anything like the king and royal guard before, which indeed they hadn't, because the king, Fred, had visited all the major cities of Cornucopia after his coronation. Nobody had thought it worth his while to visit the faraway marshlands. Simple people, yes, but rather touching, aren't they? The king called gaily to his men as some ragged children gasped at the magnificent horses. They'd never seen animals so glossy, well fed in their lives. And they were all we supposed to say tonight. Flapoon murdered, muttered to Spittleworth, eyeing the tumble down stone cottages. No taverns here. Well, there's one comfort at least, Spittleworth whispered back. He'll have to rough it like the rest of us, and we'll see how much he likes it. They rode on through the afternoon, and at last, as the sun began to sink, they caught sight of the marsh where the Ickabog was supposed to live. A wide stretch of darkness studded with strange rock formations. Your Majesty, called Major Beamish, I suggest we set up camp now and explore the marsh in the morning. As Your Majesty knows that the marsh can be treacherous, fogs come suddenly here. We do the best to approach it by daylight. Nonsense, said Fred, who was bouncing up and down his saddle like an excited schoolboy. We can't stop now. When it's in sight, Beamish, the king had given his orders, so the party rode until at last, when the moon had risen and was sliding in and out behind the inky clouds, they reached the edge of the marsh. It was the eeriest place any of them had ever seen. Wild and empty and desolate. A chilly breeze made the rushes whisper, but otherwise it was dead and silent. As you see, sire, said Lord Spittleworth after a while, the ground is very boggy. Sheep and men alike would be sucked under if they wandered out too far. Then the feeble-minded might take these giant rocks and boulders from monsters in the dark. The rustling of these weeds might even be taken for the hissing of some creature. Yes, true, very true, said King Fred, but his eyes still roamed over the dark marsh, as though he expected Ickabog to pop up from behind the rock. Shall we pitch camp then, sire? Asked Lord Flapoon, who saved some gold pieces of barren stone and was eager for his supper. We can't expect to find even an imaginary monster in the dark, pointed out Spittleworth. True, true, repeated King Fred, regretfully. Let us, good gracious, how foggy is it? It has become. And sure enough, as they stood looking out across the marsh, a thick white fog had rolled over them, and swiftly and silently, that none of them had noticed it. I don't like Spittleworth and Flapoon. They're not nice people. So much for watching. Don't forget to please subscribe, give me a thumbs up, share, comment, and I will talk to you in my next video.